Hello, my name is Diana Marin, and today I'll be presenting SIGDT 2D curve reconstruction. We will start talking about cats, or at least presuming that you can see a cat's contour in the points on the screen. This is exactly the issue that we're trying to solve. How does our brain know how to get from that bunch of points to this? This is the issue of curve reconstruction, and actually it's a really complicated problem, even though our visual system has no issue in solving it whatsoever. There are multiple factors that can be taken into consideration for curve reconstruction, and these are proximity, how close the points are to one another, if we want a smooth curve, if we want continuity, or if we want a closed one. And in order to solve this, we have introduced a new proximity graph, which is a graph which encodes the closeness of points. It's an intersection between the spheres of influence graph and the Delaunay triangulation. The spheres of influence graph will be, I'll talk about it in more detail soon. We have also proved that we require less points for reconstruction than previous methods, and we have used this graph in combination with some steps from another curve reconstruction method in order to achieve the best results for manifold reconstruction. But before I go into more details about our work, I will talk a bit about related works. And related works can be put into two big categories, and also others. Explicit methods and implicit methods. Explicit methods are usually compute a graph on the input points. They are also called interpolatory methods because they try to get edges from this graph, and that is the final reconstruction. In terms of implicit methods, these usually try to compute a function, an inside-outside function, and then get the zero set of that function as the actual curve reconstruction. But now going back to the explicit method, because also our method is a type of explicit method, I will introduce some mathematical concepts. For the red curve, we sample it with the points in black, and then we have the medial axis, which is the collection of points which are at equal distance to at least two points on the curve, and that is the black curve. And now, that is the medial axis. And now for every point on the curve, we can define the local feature size as the distance, Euclidean distance, to the medial axis. We can also define the distance to each sample points between any point on the line. And with this, we can use the epsilon. You can use epsilon sampling, which is the ratio between the local feature size of a point and the distance to the nearest sample. This is a way of communicating that when in areas with important features, we need more samples, and in areas with less features, like on a flat part of the curve, we need less samples. This has been introduced by Crust, and the current best value for epsilon, like which means that we require the less samples, has been achieved in connectivity 0.5, but they also require a non-uniformity ratio of 1.6. The non-uniformity ratio is just the ratio between the two neighboring edges for each point. So we are not allowed to have a big difference between neighboring edges. We have managed to improve on this, keeping epsilon 0.5, but increasing the non-uniformity ratio, so we are able to reconstruct more curves. Our method is constructed as follows. We will start from an initial graph, which tries to approximate the surface. And from this, we want to inflate it, which means that we add Delaunay triangles to it, such that all the points are either on the boundary or inside the boundary. And from this, we now sculpt. We just sculpt away some of the triangles to expose the points that are inside of the boundary to the boundary. Now I'll go into a bit more details about how our method actually works. And we start in the face of the initial graph. As I've said before, we first compute the spheres of influence graph. This has been introduced by Toussaint in '88, initially as a clustering method. And two points are connected in the SIG if the distance between them is less than the sum of the respective nearest neighbors. Visually, this can be easily interpreted as centering a circle around each point and expanding it until it touches the nearest neighbor, and then connecting all of the points whose circles intersect. This is now our spheres of influence graph, but we also need the Delaunay triangulation. So we compute that on the input points, we save away the spheres of influence graph, and then we combine them, we intersect them to obtain the SIGDT. This graph is now used as the initial graph for our next steps. But we still need to do a bit of more post-processing, because we have lift nodes, and for inflate, we actually need a closed surface. We first need to find the lift vertices, which are highlighted in blue, and then we look through the Delaunay edges that are not yet part of the reconstruction and add the shortest one to the graph. This leaves us with a complete initial graph, and we now can go on to the inflate step. First, for this, we have to find non-manifold vertices. Non-manifold vertices are either vertices which have more than two neighboring edges on the boundary, or whose both planes are part of the outside of the shape. These are highlighted in blue now, and we look for incident triangles which are considered candidates, highlighted in gray. We want to add to the reconstruction the triangles which least increase the total boundary length, and we start from the triangle on the bottom. After we have added this triangle, we recompute again the possible candidate triangles. None of our two non-manifold vertices have been resolved yet, so we continue looking, we add the next triangle, but this actually makes one of the vertices manifold. So this means that we don't need to take in its incident triangles as candidates anymore. We are just left with the candidate triangles of the blue vertex. We continue the procedure and we add our last triangle to the shape. And now there are no non-manifold vertices left. However, we are left with a lot of inside edges that we don't actually need for our boundary, so we just get rid of them in another step. Now our shape contains all the points on the outside or inside of the boundary, so we can continue with sculpt. For this, we first find the interior vertices, and we once again look through the candidate triangles, and try to add the triangle that least increases the boundary length. In this case, we don't actually add them like for inflate, we XOR them, which means that after we have chosen the triangle that least increases the boundary length, we add the edges that were not yet part of the reconstruction and remove the edge that was both part of the triangle and the reconstruction. After we have done this, there are no more interior vertices left, and we end up with the final reconstruction of our shape. Moreover, we have presented a proof that our graph, our proximity graph, contains the reconstruction of a smooth planar curve if the curve is sampled with epsilon 0.5 and non-uniformity ratio 0.2 of 2. And now for the curve in red, we have the consecutive samples as 0, 1, 2, and 3. And we want to show that the edge between the two consecutive samples, S1 and S2, is part of the SIGDT. In order to do this, we first have to show that it's part of the SIG. And this is true because of the epsilon sampling. S0 is the nearest neighbor of S1, and S3 is the nearest neighbor of S2. Hence, the circles centered at each of these points intersect, so E is part of the SIG. And also, if we center a circle on the middle of the edge E, this edge will contain no other samples, and means that E is also part of DT. However, I have only offered a really high-level overview of the proof. For more details, please refer to the paper. Now, in terms of results, our method manages to have the best results for manifold curves, which is also the highest, the most common type of curves that there are there. In red, you can see the results of our method, and in stripes, we have highlighted the best method. Our method, only 8.5% of the curves are left are not reconstructed by our method, compared to 9.7% for the second best. And we also have an example of a manifold curve. All of these results have been achieved using the curve 2D curve reconstruction benchmark. And we also have results for the sharp corners. The best method is once again highlighted with stripes, and that is GATT&G, which is a method specialized in curve reconstruction, in reconstruction of curves with sharp corners. And our method is highlighted with red. It manages to surpass the method that it has been inspired from, that it's building upon. But it's still not the main method, considering that GATT&G is specialized in curves with sharp corners. We have also tried to confront our method with trying to reconstruct curves with uniform noise, and the results of our method are similar to methods from the same category. And the same applies for curves with local feature size based noise. In terms of limitations, our method is not intended for non-manifold curves. So in the case of non-manifold curves, actually the reconstruction is not as intended, but it still manages to reconstruct most of the shape, once again considering that it's not intended for non-manifold curves. Furthermore, we work with one connected component, closed one, and our output should be manifold, so open curves are also not correctly reconstructed by our method because the shape gets closed. However, most of the shape is still reconstructed as intended. And another limitation is constituted by multiple curves. But once again, we are working with one connected component, and this is not a test case that our method has been designed for. In case that the sampling conditions are not met, that is another case where our method fails to correctly reconstruct the shape. But we managed to reconstruct extremely dense curves. The complexity is not increased from the previous method, it's still n log n. And we have been working a lot with the silhouette data from images on the 1,200 data sets that are present in the benchmark, in the manifold one. And we are also able to reconstruct, as showed in the congregated results, the curves with sharp corners. In terms of future work, one point would be to address the limitations that are not yet considered in our method, the open, multiple, and non-manifold curves, considering that we are only working with one connected component and manifold curves at the moment. And obvious choice for future work on this method is to extend it to surface reconstruction and move it to three dimensions. In conclusion, we have introduced SIGDT as a new proximity graph, and we managed to prove that it contains the reconstruction using less points than previous methods, than state of the art. And we have proved that it is the best manifold curve reconstruction method out there using the benchmark and using some steps from a previous method, starting from our proximity graph. Thank you for your attention, and if there are any questions, you can also find our method online, open source, using the QR code on this slide. Thank you.